There is no one else here. It is eerily quiet.
Hi, strangers. I want to put a finishing bow on this story. I've been working on this for 2 years. And honestly, sometimes I still have a hard time believing that it happened. That Nellie and Liz did it. And they came back relatively unscathed. They both took the adventure on, living in a world where a cut could have killed either of them. They traveled when weather forecasting was less accurate. Train travel was so hazardous that doctors were always stationed to live near the railroads in case of accidents. The Titanic hasn't even happened yet. They only relied on maps and telegraphs and hearsay. And they both passed through a disease-riddled world, hurtled over fault lines, traversed through rainstorms over oceans, and neither one of them came back with even a cough. But they definitely came back changed. But at the end of it all, I like to think that both women won. Nellie gets her perfect ending. Nellie set a world record. She gets all of the fame and glory. While I like to think that Liz won as well, because what was ticking for her wasn't a clock, but her heart. She measured her time in love and gratitude, not speed. So how do you come back to your normal life after a trip like this? Well, I think it's fair to say that neither of their lives were ever normal. But once the race was over, both lives took different shapes. So let's start with Liz. Once she settled from her harrowing trip across the Atlantic, this adventure did jumpstart Liz's love of travel.
I was a young woman, quite alone and doing a somewhat conspicuous and eccentric thing. Yet, throughout the entire journey, I never met with other than the most exquisite and unfailing courtesy and consideration. It seems to me this speaks very highly for the civilization existing in all traveled parts of the globe.
Although she doesn't get to explore London on her trip, she does take the next year to live abroad in the UK. She made friends with a lord and lady on her journey, and they invited her to live with them in England for a year. And Liz accepts. She's still able to work on her column for Cosmopolitan and other publications. She did everything you're supposed to do when you live with a lord and lady. Boat races, balls, fancy dinners, and attend a garden party hosted by the Prince of Wales. And while Liz is there, Charles Wetmore, a lawyer who had been courting her back in the States, takes the trip across the Atlantic to visit her. They get married within the year. When they arrive back in New York, they move out to Long Island into an old Tudor-styled home, and they live with one of Liz's sisters. Liz loves it there. It's the best of New York society and the lush greenery she grew up with. Charles adored Liz. And Liz doesn't give up her job for him. She still continues to edit other people's work and write her own, often about the place of women in society. Her life was still as sweet as when she lived above the candy shop. Then, after 10 years of marriage, Charles fell ill with a mysterious chronic disease. So Liz decides there's only one medicine for it. To travel to Japan. It's unclear if they took Liz's original route out west. Even though I'm sure Liz felt anxious about her husband's health, it would have been so delightful to go on a road trip across America. And now Liz and her husband are the ancient little lovers who don't want to talk to anyone but each other. Only now, Liz gets the trip she's always wanted. Slow travel, easy mornings and long nights. Indulgent walks through gardens and temples. No clock, rushing her from one spot to another. And doing it all with the love of her life. And they don't go back to America after that. They traveled for a year and went to China, Singapore, Ceylon, and India. But even with all of this awe-inspiring travel, it didn't abate Charles's illness. So they decided to move to the English countryside for some peace and fresh air. Until the war hits. In 1914, Liz volunteered in local hospitals, tending to wounded British soldiers who fought in the war to end all wars. This experience crumbled her spirit and skewed her perception of how the world works. As someone who had seen so much of the beauty and kindness that the world offers, this war felt unfathomable. Not long after, Liz and Charles returned to the States and moved to D.C. Liz tended to Charles and continued to volunteer for the war efforts. She planted a beautiful garden, but Charles's state only worsened. On Christmas Eve in 1918, Charles was admitted to a sanitarium, and doctors didn't allow Liz to visit. They feared she would be a distraction from his healing. Little did she know that cold December night was the last time she ever saw her husband. He died 6 months later alone in the sanitarium, longing for his wife. She spent those 6 months in agony, unable to enjoy anything. She lived in uncertainty every day and longed to be with her husband. Then in June, when she received the news of his passing, she felt that all of the meaning and purpose was sucked out of her life. She busied herself with her garden and charity work, helping poor women and girls, and always writing and advocating for women. Then in 1922, she took another trip back to China and Japan, alone. I assume she again took the train across America and sailed across the Pacific. The way she did, all alone and unsure of everything, all those years ago. She walked Chinese and Japanese grounds the way she did as that romantic 28-year-old who had no idea why she was there. But now she returned and explored with the wisdom of an old woman who had loved very deeply during her time on this magnificent planet. She returned to America, sold her DC place, and moved to Charlottesville, Virginia, the perfect midpoint of the East Coast. It's the most northern region that southern plants can grow, and the most southern region that northern plants can grow. How fitting. Because by then, Liz had become a perfect midpoint of the East Coast herself. She lived out the rest of her days under the shadow of the glaciated Blue Ridge Mountains. Then in 1929, 10 years after Charles died, Liz passed away from pneumonia. Her obituary was printed in the New York Times. It mentioned her as a writer, but nothing about her race. Her body was brought up north, and she was buried next to her husband. Nellie's life is a bit more of a roller coaster, which is on brand. After 2 months of full independence, the difficulty of being a woman reared its ugly head when she returned to America. When she arrived back, everyone was in awe of her, and they put her face on everything. School bags, sewing kits, chicken feed, constipation pills, anything they could smack her face on, they did. There's no evidence or receipts that Nellie ever got any financial compensation from companies using her image. But Nellie loved the attention, so it didn't bother her. She does, however, go on a lecture tour around America to tell her story to the nation. And she gets pushback from journalists, shaming her for trying to make a profit from her experience. Sure, companies can exploit her, but how dare she try and make her own money? She did it anyway, but a string of bad luck followed her for the year after the race. The lecture tour fell flat and ended early. Then she gets roped into a lawsuit. The New York World was sued for Nellie's undercover reporting on a piece she did before the race. However, she refused to testify on the New York World's behalf because they never said thank you for her going around the world, let alone any extra compensation, given how much money they made off of the guessing game. This dispute tarnished Nellie and Pulitzer's relationship, and Nellie left the newspaper. Her face was too recognizable to do anything undercover anyways. So she moved to White Plains with her mom, and then she fell ill, and the next few years are hazy. Her fame and money wanes. A few years later, the New York World gets a new chief editor, and Nellie is offered her old job back, which she takes because who knows how she's making money. This is how she ended up on a train headed to Chicago to report on a strike. And on that train, she met Robert Seaman, a 70-year-old millionaire. They eloped within 2 weeks. She got to strike that goal off her list. But journalists called her a gold digger and wrote that her marriage was the biggest stunt she has done so far. But Nellie paid them no mind. She quit her job and moved into Robert's luxurious brownstone on West 37th Street. They traveled to Europe for 4 years and visited France, England, Italy, and Austria. When her husband died, she took over running his factories, and she trusted the wrong financiers who embezzled the funds and bankrupted the company. It got Nellie into major financial trouble. And to avoid dealing with any of it, she left for Europe because the war broke out. At the 11th hour, she was rehired by the New York World to report on World War I and returned to Europe. She spent 5 years in exile. She also tended to wounded soldiers in Austria. When the war was over, she returned to the States, settled up her money problems, and was hired at the Evening Journal. She used her column to write about poor families, single women in need, and children struggling to find housing. She pleaded for reader sympathy, just like she did as that plucky young journalist at the Pittsburgh Dispatch. In her column, she does shout-outs for clothing donations, jobs, housing, and sometimes took in children herself until they could be adopted. she spent her time trying to pull up as many people as she could from the similar situations she found herself in as a young girl. Her last few years were spent writing and advocating for the poor and for women. Then at age 57, Nellie died of pneumonia. The race took up a full page in her New York Times obituary. Neither woman had any children. Both pulled themselves out of their circumstances. They were always strong voices for women and were always writers at heart. They both wrote until their dying days. And even though the whole nation knew about Nellie Bly's race, there was only ever one other person who would ever really understand what she went through. And this is one question I can't get out of my head. Did they ever meet each other? I can't find any records of it happening, and that breaks my heart. On November 14th, 1889, they didn't live far away from each other. Their apartments were only 3 blocks and 3 avenues away. And the journalist world had to be small back then, especially for women. But it seems like they both remained a mystery to one another, which is so sad because they would have had so much to talk about. They would have been able to process everything they went through because they did the same thing. How nice it would have been to have someone else understand all of the feelings and the anxiety and the loneliness and homesickness and absolute wonder of it all. I think that Nellie and Liz would have found that in each other, especially because Liz would have had a chance to explain that she was bullied into this whole race. But I like to think that both women would have connected so deeply. They could have talked about how stunning the Alps are, how hot it is in Singapore, and clutch each other when they talk about what a treasure Japan is. They would have seen that they had another person out there who understood the crazy journey they went on. But there is one little fact that gives me peace. At the end of the day, after 2 separate lives and journeys, they both are buried in Woodlawn Cemetery in the Bronx, and I went to go and visit them. After spending all of this time in their words, behind books, I decided I wanted to see something that made them feel real to me. And to say hello.
I can't believe I'm still in the city because it's so quiet and there's so many little graves all around me.
I went on November 14th, 2023, the 134th anniversary of the day that both women left. It was a bright blue fall day. There was still tons of yellow, red, and orange leaves on the trees. I got off the subway and entered the cemetery. And when I stepped in, there was a noticeable temperature drop.
We're gonna visit Nellie first.
As I walked to Nellie's grave, there were huge white clouds in the sky. And I didn't see a single soul around me.
Oh, we passed it. Where is she? She's close. Oh my God, wait, I think I see it.
I walked through the row of graves, all orderly and embedded into the ground. And there was one that stood taller than the rest. And I kid you not, when I found Nellie's grave and stood in front of it, the clouds parted and there was only the sun above me.
Oh my God. Oh my God. She's right under me. Oh my God. She's right here.
Her Her grave was a large rectangle, about 2 to 3 feet high. And it read,
"Dedicated June 22nd, 1978 to Nellie Bly, Elizabeth Cottrell Seaman, by the New York Press Club, in honor of a famous news reporter, May 5th, 1864 to January 27th, 1922.
Should have brought more lash glue.
Her grave was so fitting. She was alone, but surrounded by so many people.
Oh, you lived a hell of a life, girl. I hope you're resting peacefully. Okay, let's go see Liz.
It was about a 13-minute walk from Nellie to Liz. And it just blows my mind that out of the 300,000 tombs, they are still so close to each other.
Damn, these are not graves. Some of these are crypts. Some of these are tiny houses. Okay, we're getting close to Liz.
And when I got to Liz, I noticed that the closest tree was a Japanese maple in full bold red nearby.
Oh shit, she's got like a huge one. Oh wait, oh my god, I think this is it. Interesting. Oh my god, here she is. Oh my god, here she is. Oh my god, oh my god, oh my god. Oh my god, oh my god. Oh my god. Oh wow, oh my god, Liz. Holy shit, you're right here. Oh my god. Oh my god, Elizabeth. Oh god, you've got a great grave on. Oh my god. Oh my god, it's so cool. It's her and her husband. And it's this big square with like a half circle on top. And like there's all of these roses, there's like great gauntlets, there's like flowers on it. Of course there's flowers on it.
Liz's grave says, "To the dear memory of Charles Whitman Wetmore, 1854 to 1919, and his wife, Elizabeth Bisland, 1861 to 1929. And the engraving says, "Wishing the holy where Zeus lives, the most within, the essential element of calm." God damn it, Liz.
Liz, I love how you see the world. I really loved how you saw the world. And what you were asked to do is so insane. And you still did it. The best time, except for the ending, but you know, that middle part was really fucking good.
I noticed that some people had left little stones, which I didn't even know was a form of offering. Felt so silly that I didn't grab anything for them. But I did make a whole show. A way to immortalize them and bring them to life for a little longer.
Now, they went off and lived in lots of different corners of the world, and they both died in different places, but they were both buried here. And that, I think, is just a beautiful poetic ending to this story, that they are always tethered.
There was something so sobering standing above their graves and knowing that their bones were under me. I felt that in writing this, it's really easy to slip into this mindset that they were characters, that they weren't once living, breathing humans with their own wants, desires, and motives that they never wrote down, that I will never know and understand or have a chance to decipher. So I needed to feel that it was real, that they were real,
because what they did was so unreal. And I often think back on my own trips and question if they ever happened. And it was nice to share company with two women who understood what is so hard to describe. They know all of the anxiety and homesickness and loneliness and awe of what happens to you when you travel alone. I've spent a large part of my life traveling alone. And those are times that no one else is ever gonna understand, no matter how many books or podcasts I write. Those moments traveling alone are completely my own. So being with other women who are bold enough to take that leap and read their stories and give them voices makes my solo trips feel less lonely and less weird. Because other women have had firsthand experience with the magic that happens when you travel alone, when you see the world with your own eyes and you hear your voice clearly. So going to their graves was the closest I could get to sharing space with them. So as I left the graveyard and stepped off of their shoulders, I will continue to carry their torch, writing my way through the world. A Race Around the World was written, produced, researched, rewritten, narrated, scripted, edited, edited again, re-edited one last time, then soundscaped, scored, mixed, and mastered by me, Adrien Behn. Sam Dingman was our editorial consultant and emotional support. Resources include 80 Days by Matthew Goodman, Around the World in 72 Days and Other Writings by Nellie Bly, In Seven Stages, A Flying Trip Around the World by Elizabeth Bisland. And for more resources, go to our website, strangersabroadpodcast.com. Please go to Apple Podcasts to rate, review, and subscribe to A Race Around the World. If you're interested in all of the bonus content, anecdotes, and historical facts that didn't get into the show, head over to our TikTok at Strangers Abroad Podcast. If you would like to email us, please send over a lovely message to strangersabroadpodcast@gmail.com. Thank you so much for listening. Safe travels to everyone listening.